Thank you very much. I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus, and ask members please to take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The next item of business is a statement by Michael Russell on Brexit update. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Michael Russell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, a month has passed since the UK Government's Trade and Cooperation Agreement with the European Union came into effect on the 1st of January. As this beds in, it's important to look at what has happened and to try and discern what are, in the words of the UK Government, teething troubles, or what arise from the fact that the UK has made itself, deliberately and permanently, a third country with a more distant, more expensive and less advantageous trading arrangement with its former EU partners. It's also right that I report on the steps the Scottish Government has taken to mitigate the effects of both the short-term and the longer-term problems. To be absolutely fair, some initial problems were inevitable in the light of the scale and nature of the change in relationship, and the very short notice, in fact, no notice at all, that was able to be provided in terms of detail, given that the agreement was only concluded some 7 days before it was due to come into effect, and at least one of those days was a holiday. The incontrovertible fact is that Scotland has now been forcibly removed from the world's best integrated and successful single market, one worth £16 billion in exports to Scottish companies. And moreover, this has been done at the very depth of a global pandemic, in which jobs are being badly hit and our economy is in severe recession. It's also an incontrovertible fact that 4 weeks into the new trading arrangements, the problems for businesses are not diminishing, but multiplying and spreading across different sectors of the economy. It is a fact that exporters are struggling with new customs controls, rules of origin, and non-tariff barriers. They are experiencing additional costs, stock is being delayed, and sometimes even spoiled at logistic hubs in Scotland and ports in the UK and EU. In reality, those endeavouring to do business are essentially having to live test extraordinarily complex, costly, and time-consuming new procedures which have been rushed into place. It is also a fact that since the 1st of January, we have seen significantly reduced freight flows at the short straits and on the Irish routes. The Irish government at the weekend announced that while direct transportation to the EU from Ireland is up 100%, traffic on the Irish sea routes is down 50%. Yet even with reduced volumes, disruption at our borders continues. Last Friday, the CBI, the British Chambers of Commerce, Make UK, the Federation of Small Businesses, and the Institute of Directors released a joint statement setting out the substantial difficulties faced by firms adapting to the new customs processes, sizable obstacles to moving goods through the Dover-Calais route, and the shortage of informed advice. They warned that grace periods agreed with the EU would expire over the next 2 months, at a time when cross-border traffic was due to grow, and that unless measures were put in place to smooth customs procedures, the situation would deteriorate further. Indeed, as reported by Politico, according to the UK government's own reasonable worst-case scenario, 142,000 tonnes of perishable goods, including food, feed and drink, could be wasted over the next 6 months because of Brexit border disruption. Yet in contrast to these informed views, what we are actually seeing is the UK government, in its desperation to present Brexit as a success, playing down the impacts of the end of the transition period. So the lack of significant disruption in traffic at the short straits is hailed as a success, without highlighting the significant reductions in flow we have seen since the transition period ended. The fact is that flows have still not recovered after almost 5 weeks, and may never recover. Furthermore, a much higher proportion of HGVs leaving the UK are now empty as they head to pick up supplies on the continent. But far too often what we are seeing is unambiguous data of this kind glossed to fit a predetermined narrative, even if that narrative does not reflect the actual lived experience of many businesses. So, Presiding Officer, I can say today that in order to address this issue, the Scottish Government is asking the UK Government to work constructively with us and the other devolved administrations to agree a set of information that will provide a clear view of what is happening on the ground and foster mutual confidence in the data. Just as the UK government strenuously avoided an economic impact study of its Brexit policies, it is avoiding the close examination of what is actually happening on the ground as a result of those policies having been implemented. And indeed, it's even denying reality when confronted with it. For a long time, Scottish government modelling has indicated that it was likely to be the seafood and agricultural sectors which would be the first to bear the brunt of EU exit. That has proved to be the case. The disruption to the seafood sector has resulted in damaging delays, huge costs, and devastating losses, which we feared would be the outcome of becoming an EU third country and dealing with new and untested processes. It is very obvious already that the benefits of the so-called Sea of Opportunity were not delivered by the UK government in the negotiations, are not being delivered now, and will not be delivered in the future. For the second time in even the Prime Minister's bizarre definition of a generation, Scottish fishermen have been tricked and deserted by a UK government and a UK Prime Minister, and a Prime Minister who didn't even have the guts to meet those same fishermen last week, nor to acknowledge the damage he had done. The truth is that the tide of that sea of opportunity has turned, and it has turned against Scottish fishermen. They were promised a greater share of their catch, but instead they have seen reduced access to key species such as cod and haddock, and are now dealing with crippling red tape and plummeting sales. Industry groups have universally condemned the deal, with the National Federation of Fishermen's Organisations calling it minuscule, marginal, paltry and pathetic, whilst the Scottish Fishermen's Federation said the Brexit deal falls far short of commitments and promises. Seafood exporters, who have reported loads being rejected at the border control post and either being destroyed or returned at the exporter's cost, have simply called the whole situation catastrophic. For even when goods eventually get through, the freshness and quality of produce is often affected, so the price received by exporters is lower. One senior industry figure in my constituency sent me an email last week which said, without the expletive, "Michael, do everything in your power to get us the hell out of the UK and back into the EU, or Scotland won't have a seafood industry left." And there are other effects as well. Ports such as Lochinver, a fragile community in a fragile area, are losing trade because EU vessels, worried about red tape and dealing with the third country systems, are choosing to land in Ireland. And we've seen Peterhead markets suffering as vessels land their catch in Denmark to make use of their EU membership. The whole coastal economy is being hit. In response to public pressure, the UK government announced funding of up to £23 million to support seafood exporters across the whole of the UK. However, industry groups estimate as much as £1 million a day is being lost by some merchants, and in addition, it doesn't seem likely that this money will reach those that need it most, as those able to benefit do not include catchers who have tied up due to an inability to sell their catch, or those who have suffered loss due to, understandably, incorrect filing of the paperwork. That is why the Scottish Government have announced today that we will provide an additional £7.8 million to support Scottish seafood businesses and individuals in that sector who were failed by the Brexit deal and who are now being failed by the UK Government's inadequate compensation scheme. This money will seek to protect and preserve vital jobs in our coastal communities. In addition to this, we will continue to back calls from our food and drink industry for a six-month grace period to allow exporters more time to digest the outcome of negotiations and change as best they can. Unfortunately, Presiding Officer, it's not just the fishing part of the food industry that's being impacted. As the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Economy and Tourism set out last week, a whole new category of prohibited and restricted goods has been created, meaning Scottish exporters can no longer trade their produce freely with the EU. Because of the UK government's refusal to align UK seed potato regulations with the EU, Scottish seed potato farmers will no longer be able to export their product to Europe, their biggest market, resulting in estimated immediate losses of around £11 million. All this confirms that whilst businesses and SMEs were promised last year that Brexit would open up a raft of new opportunities in new markets, reality this year is that already 38% of SMEs say that their trade with the EU will decrease as a result of Brexit, and 32% are saying costs associated with running their businesses will be impacted. Instead of providing the business community with exciting new opportunities, the UK government is actually putting businesses in a position where they may have to shrink to survive or even move location to the EU, as apparently is the advice from the UK government economic sources. Presiding Officer, there are wider impacts too. It's currently estimated that 1.3 million EU citizens have left the UK. That is 1.3 million people who work tirelessly in hospitals, universities, in every sector and at every level. 1.3 million people whose talents we need and whose presence enriches us all, but who have been alienated by the rhetoric and actions of a Brexiteer UK government that rejoices in the end of freedom of movement. The Scottish Government is seeking to counter that. We need EU citizens, so our Stay in Scotland campaign pledges to stand by and protect the rights of those European citizens who choose to call Scotland their home and offers a package of support to help them stay. I once again urge all EU citizens who want to stay in Scotland to ensure they apply to the UK government's settled status scheme by the 30th of June this year. You are welcome here. Please stay in Scotland. And the futures of our young people have also taken a profound hit by this low deal. Due to an explicit last-minute UK government decision, the justification for which has not been shared with the devolved administrations, Scotland will also no longer be able to participate in Erasmus Plus, which has benefited over 2,000 Scottish HE students and over 1,100 FE students a year. Amongst other positive benefits, Erasmus, which goes much wider than HE provision and the parameters of the supposed UK replacement, which again hasn't been discussed with us, it improves participants' self-confidence, language learning, cultural awareness, and employability. That is why the Minister for Further Education, Higher Education and Science is pursuing the issue, has met with the relevant EU Commissioner, and along with all of us, is grateful to Terry Rentke and David McAllister, who have organised an amazing letter, signed by over 150 of their fellow MEPs, supporting devolved access to the scheme. Danke, Freunde. The deal has also had significant impact on the fight against crime in Scotland, with Police Scotland and the Crown Office now having to use slower and less effective tools. The loss of access to the Schengen Information System database means Police Scotland will no longer have access to real-time or immediate alerts from EU partners on wanted or missing persons. Another serious loss is a European arrest warrant, as a new system allows EU member states to refuse to extradite their own nationals to Scotland. However, even when EU member states permit surrender, bringing someone to face justice in Scotland will also likely take longer and cost more than it would have under the European arrest warrant. The deal does little to facilitate access to the single market for our financial services sector, a sector that employs 87,000 people in Scotland with exports valued at 8.6 billion. Now, I appreciate that the EU and the UK are aiming to agree a further memorandum of understanding on financial services by next month. But if it happens, it will focus on regulatory cooperation and, as we understand it, will do nothing to reinstate our lost market access. Presiding Officer, the UK government has now admitted that these are not teething issues. They are a permanent exclusion from the single market that leaves many businesses in Scotland toothless in a competitive modern economy. I could go on. Some professions are already experiencing the loss of mutual recognition, such as architects. There is not now legal protection for our geographical indicators, producing new uncertainty about the market advantage of excellence from Scotland. And despite the ludicrous and offensive decision by the European Commission on Friday about Article 16 and vaccines, fortunately quickly rescinded, the aggressive refusal to officially recognise, uniquely in the world, the EU ambassador in London speaks to a negative agenda still being pursued by the UK government when a positive one is now urgently required. There was a further sign of that in Michael Gove's remarks yesterday about the Northern Ireland Protocol. The negotiations for which he oversaw, the implementation committee for which he co-chairs, and the details of which he told us all last month, delivered the best of both worlds. And presiding officer, I have not even mentioned as yet the cost of all this. The Tories here were baying for blood last week when they thought, mistakenly, that the Scottish government had recently spent £100,000 on an independence referendum. But their party and government in the UK is meeting a vastly, vastly greater bill for this Brexit burach. Bloomberg Economics estimated last year a minimum cost to the economy of £130 billion. Even the Bank of England expects the cost to the economy to be about £80 billion. Direct spending by government, even on its own Brexit preparations, has been at least £8 billion in the last 4 years and is probably much higher. And of course, it is still costing and still being pursued at the depth of the pandemic crisis. We in the Scottish Government, however, remain determined to act as positively as we can, despite that rank hypocrisy. In our agencies and through the Building Resilience Steering Group, we've been offering a wide range of help to those affected. For example, by Food Standards Scotland putting additional staff into the three Scottish logistic hubs, by recruitment and training of more specialised customs agents, and by tailored advice and support to businesses on completing paperwork. Through our enterprise agencies, we are also building on the engagement they had with the 1,400 most Brexit-vulnerable companies before Christmas, supporting them to adapt to the challenges we're facing. We published our Scotland's Vision for Trade last Tuesday, which sets out Scotland's trade policy priorities post-EU exit and demonstrates the role of trade as a social, environmental and economic lever in Scotland's economic recovery. And our work will continue for as long as it is needed. As we have done throughout the Brexit process, we will continue to engage constructively with the UK government on the issues we're facing. Presiding officer, we never voted for even the softest of Brexits, which was, of course, the promise 5 years ago. What we ended up with was the hardest of Brexits, recklessly pursued at the very depths of the pandemic. That was bound to be a disaster, and it has been. It is therefore significant that polling today not only shows that Scotland, if asked again, would vote to remain by the same huge margin, but also confirms that Scotland emphatically wants to rejoin. Now, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government will, of course, continue to do everything in our power to mitigate the impacts of Brexit on this country, its business and its communities. Far from being over, the problems created by Brexit are getting worse, and we face more difficult times ahead. For the remainder of this Parliament, I will continue to keep the Chamber updated. But I will also make sure that Scotland and Scotland's neighbours understand that we regard this exit from the EU as temporary. There is a way, but only one way, to rejoin. Westminster parties have sold the pass on that matter, but Scotland's party and Scotland's government has not. The only way back is to choose independence, like virtually all the other normal small countries in Europe have done. So post-pandemic, we will redouble our efforts to secure that goal, which will allow us to rebuild our economy and our society in the way we wish, not in a way we are told to, by a Tory UK government that is the author of this terrible, continuing, costly, and indeed worsening Brexit mess. And, Presiding Officer, we can make our next significant step towards normality on the 6th of May.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement, after which I intend to allow around 30 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. Thank you very much. And I now call on Dean Lockhart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for an advance copy of his statement. The Scottish Government has received £200 million of Barnett consequentials to prepare Scottish business for Brexit, but has refused to detail how this money is being spent. So will the Cabinet Secretary agree today to publish a detailed breakdown of how this £200 million is being spent to help Scottish business prepare for the new trading arrangements? In terms of disruption to exports to the single market and under the Northern Ireland Protocol, it's becoming increasingly clear that the EU Commission is acting unreasonably. This came into sharp focus last Friday when the EU Commission invoked Article 16 of the Protocol to restrict the flow of vaccines to the UK and effectively impose a trade border on the island of Ireland. A move immediately condemned by all parties across the UK and in Ireland, but a move which was met by radio silence from the SNP. So let me ask the Cabinet Secretary, will he work with the UK government to resist any and all moves by the EU Commission to use the Northern Ireland Protocol to restrict the supply of vaccines to the UK? And in relation to his comments about the impact of Brexit and the costs to the Scottish economy, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with the report issued today by the London School of Economics, which warns that the cost of independence to the Scottish economy would be three times greater than Brexit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I have to say all those questions are very predictable, particularly the last one, which I shall come to in just a moment. But let me start with the issue of the spending of money. The Scottish Government spent far more than the £200 million on preparing for Brexit and is having to do so. But I would remind the member about the devolved settlement. The devolved settlement does not require the Scottish Government to submit its accounts for approval by the Secretary of State for Scotland. He may think that he can order the military in to Scotland, which appears to have been what he was trying to do this week, but he's not the Accountant General. We have made it absolutely clear that we are spending every penny and more on the mess that the Tories have created, and we will continue to do so. On Article 16, I appreciate that Dean Lock is a bit embarrassed, because on Friday night he dashed out this tweet condemning me for not having said anything at all about the Article 16. Regrettably, I had done so before he did, as he now knows. And he was reluctant, indeed, he was determined not to apologise for that. But he's just done it again here. I have made it clear in my speech what the position is. It is my position. It is the Scottish Government's position. It is the SNP's position. It is Scotland's position. And I'm glad it is the Scottish Tories' position, even though they came to it later than I did. And finally, on the report from the London School of Economics, I'm grateful for the opportunity to address it. I welcome all independent consideration of these matters. But I do think there's something fairly extraordinary in this report. There's an assumption in this report, which I find completely bizarre, and perhaps Dean Lockhart can help me on this. The report assumes that if Scotland were to become independent, I hope it will, we would not change a single policy. We would not use a single lever on the economy. We would not have anything new to do. We would just sit there and pretend that nothing had changed. Now, one of the key issues is trade dependence. And the Irish are a really good example of how you can use independent membership of the EU to move from trade dependence on another country to trade independence. In addition, it does not fully examine the issues of manufacturing and a whole range of other issues. I know it does thank Jim Gallagher for his input to the report, and whilst I have the greatest respect for Jim Gallagher, he could not be regarded as a man without an axe to grind on these matters, an axe that he usually likes to use on the SNP. So I'm grateful for the input, I always consider it seriously, but I have reservations about it, and I've expressed them in a reasoned and reasonable way.
I call him Anna Sauer.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for early sight of the statement. It's clear that the mess that has been set out in the statement is of the Tory party and the Prime Minister's making, and as I've said repeatedly in this chamber before, it is completely unacceptable that this is happening at a time when lives and livelihoods are still at risk and our collective focus should be on getting through COVID and recovering from it. It's clear that this is going to have an impact on trade, on the free movement of goods, and the customs checks are obviously impacting on livestock and on fisheries. But I would also ask the Cabinet Secretary, this is clearly something that's not just impacting on Scotland, it's impacting on parts of right across the UK. So what engagement has he had with metro mayors in England and also with the First Minister of Wales so we can find a collective approach to challenge the UK government on this unthinkable, unforgivable approach to how we trade in the UK? And can I say to the Cabinet Secretary, I want to find agreement with him on the issue of Brexit, and I want to work with him to get through the COVID crisis. But I do not think it's right for us to only selectively quote independent experts when it suits our personal agenda and to ridicule them when it doesn't suit our personal agenda. So him and I will have quoted the London School of Economics on Brexit, but he was willing to accept their opinion on Brexit, but is now not yet willing to accept their opinion when it comes to independence. We can't pick and choose. So instead, I would suggest to the Cabinet Secretary, let's focus on what unites us, not divides us the country, and that is getting through COVID and saving lives and livelihoods.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I too want to make as much common cause as I can with Anna Sauer, but I disagree with him on picking and choosing. I mean, surely as rational human beings, we should read a report and we should come to a conclusion as to what we agree with and what we don't agree with. We may agree with one report, we may disagree with another report. If you look at trade dependence, for example, and it's very, very significant indeed. The percentage of goods traded with the UK in 1973 in exports was 55%. And in 2018 is 11%. If you look, for example, around Europe, Danish GDP per head is 20% higher than the UK's, and Norway's is nearly 40% higher. So separating yourself out from the EU is not a good thing, but being a small independent country in Europe is a good thing. And therefore, that's not picking and choosing. That is looking at the information and coming to a reasonable conclusion. Now, having disagreed on that, let me agree with him and indeed his colleagues in Wales. Because I worked very, very closely with his colleagues in Wales, firstly with Mark Drakeford when he was my opposite number, and I have the huge respect for Mark Drakeford, and later with the Council General, Jeremy Miles, who is my opposite number. And you know, the basic element in that success in working together was this. We disagreed on the constitutional process, but we agreed on the problems of Brexit and we worked very hard together on them. So I think Anna Sauer and I are going to disagree on the constitutional journey, although I have to say the Labour Party in Wales appears to be much more open-minded on the issue, for example, of sovereignty, and be happy to debate that at any stage with Anna Sauer, but I'm happy to work with him on these issues. Final point I want to make, I think the thing he and I can also agree on, is that many of these problems arise because the UK is now a third country as far as the EU is concerned. And that is not going away. That is the problem. Whatever initial teething problems there are, that permanent change means that trading will be harder, will take longer, and cost more money. And that is the last thing we need in the middle of a pandemic.
I call Joan McAlpine to be followed by Liz Smith.
Thank you. It's clear that the agriculture sector is in need of urgent support to manage the pressures arising from the red tape thrown up by Brexit. Particularly concerning are the new limitations in exporting certain goods, such as seed potatoes, Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the UK Government should be providing more support to businesses in the agriculture sector, and can he give more details of what he thinks that support should look like?
I do agree with Joan McAlpine. I think this is going to emerge over the next few weeks and months as the agricultural industry realises the difficulties, experiences those difficulties, and the cost of those difficulties become clear. So there are probably three things that require to be done. The UK government needs to get in advance of that and estimate what the problems are and be willing to assist with them. Secondly, it needs to make sure that if there are changes that can, to systems that can be made here, they should be made. There's not likely to be many changes in systems in the EU because all those things have been agreed by the UK government. But if the UK government can perhaps show a bit of humility about this and change its systems and listen, progress might be made, but there will still be the problem of being a third country. That's not going to go away. And the third thing is the Scottish government with the Welsh government, with the Northern Irish government, and hopefully with the UK government, can perhaps have a serious conversation about the work that needs to be done. But that will require also the UK government to accept the problem. And as I indicated in my statement, it is having great difficulty in accepting that, and it is trying to bluff and bluster its way out of it, and that won't do.
Liz Smith, to be followed by Anna Bellew.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And may I try just once again with the Cabinet Secretary, because he said a lot in his own statement about what he believes are incontrovertible facts. Does he not agree that the London School of Economics report provides incontrovertible facts when it tells us in some considerable detail that independence would hit Scottish trade far harder than Brexit?
No, I don't. And the reason I don't is I'm trying to engage on this in a very serious way. The first point I would make is that the report makes assumptions, and the member will have to accept this, the report makes assumptions that no policy changes would take place. That is just impossible. I mean, it is actually, when you step back and think about it, nonsensical. But the second one is there are issues of trade dependence and trade flows that need to be looked at about how you change that. The third one is to take some objective evidence of other small countries like Denmark, like Norway, like Ireland, and see how that has changed. Now, let's add all that to the mix. The London School of Economics is venerable. I am sure the people who are involved on it are entirely people who wish to get the right results, but they are not infallible. And that is the important thing about all academic research. It is not infallible. Well, Dean Lockhart says, I'm infallible. That's nice of him to say so. I'm grateful for it, but it's not true. I'm not infallible, they're not infallible, and even Dean Lockhart is not infallible. The reality, well, it is a stunning revelation, particularly to Dean Lockhart, that is the case. But I just have to make it clear that what we do is we look at information, we judge that information, and we debate that information. What we don't do is simply say, that's it, done and dusted, I'm away now.
Annabel Ewing, to be followed by David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The July deadline for EU citizens residing in my Cowdenbeath constituency and across Scotland to apply for settled status is growing ever closer. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise whether the UK government has provided details as to how many individuals in Scotland have applied to date? And can the Cabinet Secretary confirm what the Scottish Government is doing to seek to encourage and support those eligible individuals to apply for settled status before the deadline? Thank you.
Michael Russell.
Yes, the UK government do publish those figures, I think on a three-monthly basis, but I'd require to check that. I can assure you that the minister responsible for this, who happens to be sitting behind me, will provide that information to the member just as soon as she possibly can. We've taken a number of actions to ensure that we are supporting people who have applied or are applying for settled status. I deeply regret that we have to do that, because I very much feel what constituents of my own have said to me, how insulted they feel that they're having to do this, having lived here, contributed here, been fellow citizens of ours. But regrettably, they have to apply and they should apply. And once people have settled status, then we will do everything we can to defend them and to stand up for them. And I hope the UK government will show a generosity lacking so far in recognising the contribution of those EU citizens. We have undertaken a great deal of work through, for example, the Citizens Advice Bureau to make sure that we are providing information, and we'll continue to do that, and we'll continue to reach out to citizens. For example, the First Minister did so last year on a number of occasions, most recently in December, and we will go on doing so. We want people to stay. Our Stay in Scotland campaign is crucial to this too. These EU citizens are our fellow citizens. I want to be an EU citizen with them again, and I look forward to that day.
David Stewart, to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her statement. Like the Cabinet Secretary, I'm very concerned about the effects of Brexit on our seafood industry. This was well outlined in today's Press and Journal. In the past, as the Cabinet Secretary was well aware, the Hans and Islands have benefited greatly from EU structural funds and the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund. What discussions has the Cabinet Secretary and the Cabinet over the Shared Prosperity Fund and other instruments to help protect this vital sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
I know of Mr. Stewart's very good work on these matters and his hard work for the people of the Highlands and Islands on this and other considerations. The new Shared Prosperity Fund has not been put together with the involvement or say-so or input from the devolved governments. That is simply the case. The Secretary of State for Scotland, for example, apparently is going to administer some of those funds. I know nothing about how he will do so. He regards himself as able to do all sorts of things, order troops about, be an accountant general. Presumably, he's also going to sign the checks. As far as I'm concerned, it would be far better had the precedent taken place, of ensuring the devolved governments were involved in the administration of these funds. In terms of support for the fishing industry, anybody who goes about the Highlands and Islands, whether it be in my constituency, whether it be as a regional member like Mr. Stewart, and sees the investment that we've had from those funds, money has come from the European Investment Bank and elsewhere, into the infrastructure of the Highlands and Islands, and the fact this has stopped like that, but nothing has been put in its place because not a penny is yet flowing from the new Shared Prosperity Fund, in actual fact, is a thundering disgrace and is making the people of the Highlands and Islands suffer for something they did not vote for and would not have voted for.
Ross Greer, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following the Cabinet Secretary's remarks about the Erasmus Plus scheme and Scottish Government talks with European Commissioners, could the Cabinet Secretary confirm whether the UK Government have made any indication of whether or not they would obstruct such Scottish participation? And if they were to do so, would the Scottish Government consider taking this to the courts to clarify whose competencies it falls within?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I'm sure we would consider that, but I do hope the UK government might, be sensible about this. They haven't been sensible about negotiating it. And indeed, on a number of occasions, both Jeremy Miles and myself raised at JMC, and I think on other occasions, the possibility that if the UK government did not wish to continue with Erasmus, and we thought that they did, but if they did not wish to, then we would like to see negotiation taking place for the devolved administrations to continue. This was brushed aside. I remember David Frost brushing it aside at a particular meeting. And I did raise this myself within the EU, and I was told that the UK government, it was a matter of competence between the UK government and the EU, and the UK government had made no such approach. So, in fact, that might have been possible for them to negotiate even when they were deciding that they didn't want to be part of it, but they refused to do so. But I hope better sense might prevail. I'm always hopeful that we might see a rational approach from others. And therefore, as we move forward on this, I think hope two things will happen. One is that the UK government will not interfere. But secondly, the money that might have gone on this from the UK government should be divided amongst the devolved administrations if they wish to continue, and they can make the choice whether they take part in this or whether they take part in the Turing scheme or whether they choose a bit of both.
Willie Rennie, to be followed by Ruth Maguire.
Brexit truly is a mess, and I'm grateful to the Minister for once again providing a long list of reasons why we should not repeat the mistakes of Brexit with independence. But in the spirit of consensus, can I add my support to the efforts to resolve the export routes for seafood products, particularly from my constituency in Pitt and Weem, but also support for the efforts to rejoin the Erasmus scheme, which has benefited many students right across Scotland.
Michael Russell.
I'm grateful to Mr. Rennie. I'm not going to dwell on the first sentence. I'll dwell on the other sentences and say I think it is important, just as Anna Sarwar has indicated, it's important that we try and make as much common cause as possible. The Erasmus scheme has been beneficial to so many young people. that we should all be behind it. Indeed, I remember a time when the Tories were behind it. Alas, they seem to have walked away from it. I hope they might come back to support Scottish membership and to persuade their colleagues in London to do what I have just asked for. Undersea food, this is a really tragic thing for so many producers, whether they be in Pitt and Weem, whether they be in Tarbert and Argyll. Livelihoods are being destroyed. Businesses are being destroyed. I think the scheme that Fergus Ewing has announced in terms of additional support will be helpful. But of course, we also need to make sure that there are ways for them to continue in business in the long term. And that's what we want to try and do.
Ruth Maguire to be followed by Jamie Halcrow-Jones.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my concern, and indeed that of many businesses, that sufficient steps are not being taken by the UK Government to support them to adapt to new customs processes in order to ease cross-border travel? And would he agree that additional action is absolutely essential in order to prevent further mass wastage of perishable goods?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a very interesting point, and it has two parts to it. One is that actually the COVID pandemic, because people are not travelling, is also not demonstrating the real problem here. When people start to travel as individuals again, we're going to see some very considerable problems, because every traveller from these islands will go as a traveller from outside the EU and outside the EEA. And all of us know those signs, and we will not be included in that faster flow. We will not be able, for example, to use the passport machines, which are not available to us. So as individuals, we're going to find how bad this is, and we're probably also going to find it in terms of things like mobile phone roaming. So many of the things we took for granted in recent years will simply not be available to us. And some people, for example, who live part of the time abroad are already finding it, where they're discovering there's a limitation on the time they can spend, which is 90 days out of 180. On the issue of customs clearance for goods, this is a big increased cost. I was talking to somebody this morning who was pointing out that customs agents who do this job for people were charging £125 a consignment. They're now charging £500 a consignment. And I'm not criticizing them. It's because they have so much work and they are so much in demand. You cannot meet that cost on some consignments. It is impossible. You're simply not selling enough at a big enough profit margin. So if you unless you do the work yourself, and some people can't do the work themselves, that stops those goods being exported or imported. And we're still in a period of comparative grace on that. This is going to get much, much worse. And it's wise to say that rather than to pretend that the UK government's pretending it isn't the case.
Jamie Halcrow-Johnson to be followed by Tom Arthur.
Given our businesses are still adjusting to leaving the EU, and with the serious economic challenges of COVID still to face and people's jobs and livelihoods at risk, can Mike Russell tell us which, if any, business organisations, trade bodies or industry groups agree with him that the nationalist obsession with another divisive independence referendum is the answer?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I have quoted, I think it's quite important that Mr. Halcrow-Johnson steps back a little. And perhaps rewinds to when I was giving my statement. I quoted the CBI, the British Chambers of Commerce, Make UK, the Federation of Small Business, and the Institute of Directors on a joint statement setting out the substantial difficulties faced by firms adapting and sizable objection to moving goods to the Dover-Calais route. I did not ask them about anything else. I didn't even ask them about this. They published this voluntarily. When we get into a debate about independence, I am quite happy to have that debate with Mr. Halcrow-Johnson and with those organisations about what I think will be beneficial. But what Mr. Halcrow-Johnson is engaged in, and forgive me for saying this, he's engaged in a smokescreen activity. He doesn't want to address the issues that I have raised today. And those issues are very serious. And he himself says that this has been happening during a COVID pandemic. Now, I think that the opportunity was there for that not to happen. Because all of us, every voice said to the UK government, apart from the Scottish Tories, do not do this during a pandemic. And what did they do? They did it during a pandemic. And they were warned, and I have to say, they were warned often. So I'm happy to have a debate with Mr. Halcrow-Johnson, even though he keeps shouting from a sedentary position. It's quite difficult to see that if you're watching this from elsewhere. But Mr. Halcrow-Johnson hasn't listened to a word I've said. He's just shouted from where he is. And I regret that, because in the end, he's going to have to debate this seriously.
And you can't debate seriously when you're sitting there roaring and yelling.
Tom Arthur, to be followed by James Kelly.
I remind the Chamber that I'm a member of the Musicians' Union. Presiding Officer, Scotland's music sector has been severely impacted by the pandemic and is facing future barriers to recovery in the form of the UK Government's hard isolationist Brexit deal. Will the Cabinet Secretary commit to continuing to apply pressure on the UK Government to get back round the negotiating table and strike a deal that restores musicians' right to work unhindered across these islands and the European Union?
Michael Russell.
Yes, I think one of the saddest aspects of the particular issue that Mr. Arthur raises is it is now clear that if the UK government had asked for an exemption for performing artists, it would have received an exemption for performing artists. And why David Frost, who fortunately is not to be the National Security Advisor, which makes us all sleep easier in our beds at night, I have to say, why David Frost did not ask for that, I do not know. But the circumstances is that that industry, already extraordinarily hard hit by the COVID pandemic, has now been put in an impossibly difficult position. And I do hope the UK government is considering that and might, with a degree of humility, go back and say we got that wrong. Is there something we can do?
James Kelly, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Mr. Russell makes valid criticisms of the UK government's handling of Brexit, but turning to areas where the Scottish Government has responsibility, and I ask the Cabinet Secretary, in light of the fact that local government are short of funding since 2013 of £937 million, what action is the government going to take to support local government to mitigate the adverse effects of leaving the EU?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I continue to work closely with local government. I meet COSLA on a fairly regular basis. I think Mr. Kelly perhaps misses out an element in this. And the element is that the Scottish Government itself has been under enormous pressure, and it has sought to maintain funding to local government as high as it possibly can, and certainly in a better way than has happened elsewhere. I think that we have provided resources to local government and will continue to do so, both to come through the pandemic and also to try and meet these challenges. But it is going to be tough on all of us. And Brexit is something that will be damaging to all of us. And I welcome the support from the Labour Party to make that point and to make it clearly. And I think we should make it in a unified manner too.
John Mason, to be followed by Peter Chapman.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary said that 1.3 million EU citizens have left the UK, which is obviously disappointing. Does he anticipate that farming and other sectors are going to struggle to get the labour and the staff that they need this coming year?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think there are going to be labour shortages this year. Quite clearly, there is a new scheme that the UK government has launched. It's far more bureaucratic. It'll be more difficult. That's one side of the equation. The other side of the equation is willingness. I think there are people who will say, because, for example, on agricultural labour, there is a shortage throughout Europe. In fact, there's a worldwide shortage. The shortage throughout Europe. So people can earn livings in places which, frankly, they feel are more hospitable than the UK has become, with what is a very negative view of migration. So I think there will be difficulties, there continue to be difficulties. And the real sadness about that is there doesn't need to be difficulties, because freedom of movement works for Scotland. It works extraordinarily well for Scotland. It worked for the rural parts of Scotland particularly, and it also worked for us as Scottish citizens, because we could go elsewhere. So losing freedom of movement is not something to crow about or to express pleasure in. It's deeply, deeply damaging, and it shouldn't have happened.
Peter Chapman, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In his statement, Mike Russell says their modelling showed seafood and agricultural sectors would be the hardest hit post-Brexit. Given that is the case, why has the transfer depot at Lark Hall been such a cause of delay to getting seafood out of Scotland, given this is a part of the process totally in the hands of the Scottish Government? They have failed their seafood exporters, despite knowing for months that these hubs would be required.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've seen that bizarre excuse in letters from the rickle of remaining Tory MPs in Scotland, fewer every election, and hopefully eventually none. I've seen this excuse. It's a ludicrous excuse. And what it is yet another smokescreen. We've had Mr. Harcourt-Johnson's smokescreen, and no sooner had that started to blow away than we have Mr. Chapman's smokescreen. The reality is that the suffering of the seafood industry and the suffering of the fishing industry comes from Brexit, and it comes from the betrayal of those industries by the government that Mr. Chapman not only supports, but time and time again in this chamber was telling us how wonderful this would be for the seafood industry, how wonderful it would be to fishing. And either Mr. Chapman did not know that the industry was about to be betrayed, or he did know and didn't say.
And finally, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has already affirmed its desire to continue in the Erasmus Plus scheme. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on discussions with the European Commission to explore Scotland's continued engagement with the programme? And does he share my concern about recent reports that EU students who come to study in the UK may be asked to pay for access to healthcare and claim it back, a process which could take up to a year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, the constant and increasing complexity of the problems that people will face, both going out of here to Europe and coming into here from Europe, are beginning to become clear. And whilst the Erasmus scheme is something that we would like to see and are working to have reinstated, it will, if it is reinstated, it will be in a changed environment. And the member is absolutely right to point to parts of that changed environment, and that may make it less attractive to students who are coming. Another issue is in terms of attracting EU students because of the fee structure. And I was the person who introduced that. I think we all came to realise it worked well for Scotland, and unfortunately that has had to change too. Regrettably, that has had to change too. So this is just a series of difficulties that breed one upon the other. And you know, we could move forward if the Scottish Conservatives accepted that they endorsed and supported something which has turned out to be disastrous and they should not have done so. That is where they started in June 2016, because to their credit, most of them did not support Brexit. But what they have done is they have gone along with it, and therefore they must take their share of responsibility for what has happened. We have seen no sign of that from either Mr. Harcourt-Johnston, Mr. Chapman most recently, and the other members in the chamber, and it is deeply to be regretted. I hope they will change that stance, or I have to say, I think the people of Scotland will change it for them.
Thank you very much. That concludes questions on the statement, and we will move on shortly to the next item of business.